Hi, Jeremy the Tall Trainer here, and I want to talk about 7 ways to make pounds fall off. Chances are you may have gotten here from our newsletter article, and so I wanted to give you some more information about these, so I'm not going to repeat quite so much. So, the 7 ways to make pounds fall off: environment manipulation, eliminate foods, track food, increase exercise, decrease inactivity, increase nutrient density, manage internal climate. So, we're going to look at these a little bit here. So, the first one, environment manipulation. And the most helpful thing I learned about it was the habit loop. So every habit has a cue, a routine, and reward. The cue is something that signals you to start the habit. The routine usually is the habit, and the reward is, what do I get from the habit? A cue and routine without a reward does not create a habit. It's the reward that makes you want to do it again. So it's got to be in there. But if there's nothing to cue the start of a habit, we won't get it started. In fact, that's what's missing in most good habits, is we forget to make a cue to make us do the good thing. And so we never start doing the good thing. We don't know when to start it. But a lot of times we're talking about maybe a bad habit, or something that that distracts us, something that pulls us away. And so we can start working on the cue. The cue is what's signaling that. And that's how we can manipulate our environment. So maybe it signals us to do this habit we don't like less. So we try to interrupt the cue here. So if it's in the house, I'll eat it. As where a lot of people will say that. And so that's a part that speaks to the environment. So you need to have control of the environment and you can be more successful. So possible cues to disrupt, visual cue, so you see it, so it's something you can see. So, a cereal on the counter, Dr. Brian Wansink, food researcher at Cornell, and they found in some of his research that he's done, is they found that if there's visible cereal on the countertop, is the people in the house way more. And so the visual cue there is very important. So if you see it, you eat it. Like if there's cookies on the counter, as you pass by, you just take a bite of one, or take half of one. And then next time you walk by, you take another half. By the end of the day, you've had like four or five. It adds up. It becomes something. So we try to get rid of some of those visual cues, social cues. You do what they do. And so that, in these situations, you have to watch out for these social interactions. You got to figure out, how can I thwart these social interactions? One thing is, you could try to be a hermit. That's not a great solution long term. So hermit, not necessarily good, but you may want to hang out with certain people less. It's people that take you down the wrong path. We become like the people we hang out with most. So what are the people that you're around? Do you really like them? Do you admire them? Is that because you're going to be just like that. But also, maybe you can come up with other ways to thwart in a social situation. If you're going to hang out with these people, there's no way around it. Maybe you can mess around with some of the visual cues or things like that. You put a rubber band around your hand to remind yourself not to grab something, or all sorts of random things. So the possibilities are endless. Smell, when we smell something, it makes us want to eat. So I'm very confused sometimes by people who have food smelling candles and they have a problem with cravings. And so they light these food-smelling candles, and they have a craving. They have apple pie candle, and you go, oh, I'm getting hungry when I do that. Sounds, the pop of a soda can, a lot of times will make people, want, a soda, a frying bacon. Certain sounds may trigger, a craving. So you try to decrease some of those sounds. Watch out for some of that. Locations, if you're at a stadium or your parents' house or things like that. So watching out in some of these environmental places. So if you're going to be in one of these environments, you can't stay away from it. Is figure out what you can do. Is if you're going to a stadium, you just don't go with any extra money, and then you can't really do too much damage then. Eliminate foods. So this is the idea of most diets eliminate foods. So a diet, low fat, vegan, paleo, low carb, no sugar, gluten free, they're all diets, and they all focus on eliminating something, so you have less of something. So vegan, you don't have meat. Paleo, you got way back on grains. You got low carb options, no sugar. Foods to consider for eliminating. So there's a time and place that I recommend doing some of this. I don't think really you should ban yourself from any food, because usually that's when you get nuts, you get weird, if you ban yourself from a food. But foods you consider maybe eliminating, because they could be causing inflammation in your body, and you just try it for a week or something. Try without one of these for a week and see how you feel, and that may help a little bit. So you could try a week without dairy, a week without gluten, a week without nightshades, a week without added sugar, and so you go through some of those little challenges there. And that may help you discover that maybe something was really messing you up. And maybe that could be something that sticks with you long term. I recommend never banning a food forever in your plan. And so maybe it's, for a short time you're going to go without it. Then again, then you maybe small amounts after that. Even if it's a food that bothers you, you don't want to really ban it. It needs to be more of a choice of I don't want to have that. No, I can't have that. Number three, track food. We use this method in our program. Think of it as budgeting for your calories. And so I'm a big fan of Dave Ramsey, and he's the cornerstone of all his studies. He's a financial, get out of debt guy. The cornerstone is keeping a written budget of your expenses, of your how much money is coming in, how much money is going out. And you know what the cornerstone of our program is keeping a budget for our food. Is figuring out how much calories are coming in, how much calories are going out, and getting that budget to balance there. And so when you're putting foods in, when you're keeping track of your food, what you're learning is really how much does that food cost. So instead of willy-nilly just having a food, you can know how expensive it is as far as are you going to be able to button your pants, in a year down the road eating that way. So you can start making some subtle shifts. Just knowing that something's 900 calories, maybe you only want to eat half of it. And you'll still be very happy, but now because you know that, so actually going through and keeping track, you'd learn a lot. It's a learning progression. So you've got to do these steps. You've got to learn over time. It's not an instant quick fix. This tracking food starts to discover what you are eating and how to do better. I don't think it's a forever plan. It's an intermittent plan for sure. So you may have seasons of your life where you go into tracking food and seasons where you don't. When you're managing your weight pretty well, it goes 5 pounds up, you start going, oh, maybe I better track again. Number four, increase exercise. So 1 mile of walking or running is considered 100 calories. So to lose a pound of fat, you'd have to walk 35 miles. So 5 miles a day, 7 days a week is 1 pound of body fat lost per week, which is a lot, but it's doable. It's doable. You could do that. And so you can increase your exercise. And so in fact, some very popular reality TV shows are based on people working out for like 6 hours or more per day. And so it's not this not that really awesome going crazy, it's just a boring trudging, is that that gets calories burned. So you just increase that exercise time to lose more weight. Now this isn't usually a long-term solution to do a ton of exercise, because you can't maintain it, you might get injured, and it takes a lot of your life away. You're decreasing the amount of time you have for do other things. So if you don't enjoy your exercise, don't do a ton of it. Don't go crazy on that. Resistance training can be a great option on this because the amount of time you spend in resistance training could help you build muscle mass, which a pound of muscle could help you burn an extra 6 to 10 calories per day. Doesn't sound like much, but 10 pounds of muscle extra could be 100 calories per day. That could be, the fact that you maintain your weight a lot easier with the extra 100 calories of food you get to eat and still maintain your weight. Interval training, as guys, as the EPOC, the excess post-exercise oxygen consumption. So there's the amount of calories you burn while you're exercising, but when you do interval training and resistance training, there's the EPOC too, is that you burn calories when the workout is over. So it could be for hours afterwards. I've seen some research that it's a couple of days after. I think that may be a little bit ridiculous, and I think you might feel pretty nauseous doing a workout that doesn't have much work there. But you might get some benefit there, for days or maybe half the day afterwards of a little elevation in metabolism. Not double your metabolism, just a little elevation in there. And all of those strategies can help to lose weight there. Decrease inactivity is number five. So sitting versus standing. Sitting is about 1 calorie a minute. Standing is more like 2 calories per minute. So if you just swap that out more times, that will help. So, painting the house, sweeping the floor, mowing the yard, going for a walk after dinner, all of these things are a way to get more activity. So if you're swapping out sitting time, you're sitting watching TV, if you can exchange a bunch of that out in your day, it could be massive. So if you're very, very sedentary and you get up and just start moving around, so getting up, moving around might be an extra 2 calories per minute times 60 minutes equals 120 calories. So 120 calories, you do that for 6 hours. So you're really sedentary, you're really inactive for 6 hours. Now you become active for an extra 6 hours of the day. That could be 720 calories. 720 calories per day is 72 pounds per year. So you just move the decimal point over anytime you're looking at per day kind of stuff. That's kind of fun for the year there. So 72 pounds per year gets massive. So you become a very active person. You don't sit down a lot, and that can get your weight falling off there. Increase nutrient density. Usually this means more vegetables. And so for per calorie, I mean, you can have a crazy amount of vegetables, and you also get a ton of nutrients in there. So what happens is you get full. So if you increase nutrient density, you're having these foods that have lots of nutrients in them. And so you're full. If you've ever tried to eat 2 pounds of vegetables in a day, you will get full. You know, even if you have some junk in your day too, you have a slice of cheesecake and you have 2 pounds of vegetables, you can still lose weight doing that. So make sure you have this nutrient density in there. Another idea there is to get the full amount of vitamins from pizza, you'd have to eat 6,500 calories of pizza. So it makes sense when we have 3,000 calories of pizza or pizza-like food, is that we're gonna have some problems. You know, we're gonna have some issues that come up because we're still missing some nutrients. So we're gonna have more cravings even when we've had more calories than it takes to sustain us. So increased nutrient density can help push out some other foods, but also can help get your body more satisfied. Yours more at peace because your body isn't saying, "Dude, I need this nutrient. You're not giving it to me." Last strategy is to manage internal climate. We are where we are because of our habits. To change where you are, change your habits. We have two sides to this, typically. There's an emotional side and a rational side. And so the emotional side is usually the one that, you know, we don't have very much control over. The rational side, we say, okay, logically this works and this works. That's why it's as easy as calories in versus calories out. That's the rational side of weight loss is you just burn more calories than you eat and you lose weight. Done deal. You know, the story is over. But there are two sides to this, you know, so it's not just rational, there's an emotional component there. It's not that easy to do that on a regular basis, especially if your only strategies are just eat less. You know, if you use some of these other strategies that we have, then you might have a better chance at it. But managing the internal climate is going to be huge. I recommend doing a journal of how you're feeling. So if you notice that you've got the other six things going really well, but you keep sidetracking yourself, you find yourself binge eating, you know, you end up finishing a bag of chips and you end up cursing yourself for it. You know, you end up, you know, having a, you know, ice cream every night, every night, every night. And you go like, I know I shouldn't be doing this, but why am I doing this? Ask yourself, why am I doing this? You know, what is the benefit to me? And ask yourself in a journal, find out why, you know, write it down, take the conversation in your head and put it on paper in a journal. There and you can start figuring some of that stuff out. There's a reason why you're doing it. There is a benefit. There's a benefit you're getting while you're doing it. And if you can figure out what that benefit is, maybe you can help to satisfy that benefit using a different outcome there. You can satisfy that benefit. You can take care of yourself in that way using a different source. So if you know if it's to help you feel better, maybe there's another way you can feel better. So some examples of someone using all seven techniques. This person would clean out their house, so they have to go out to get junk food. There's no stuff visible. All there's is veggies on the counter. There's veggies in the fridge. They're gonna eat more veggies. It's just gonna work that way because of they structured their environment that way. They stopped drinking soda, so they did an elimination diet there. They stopped drinking soda, and that can help the pounds fall off right there. They kept a food journal to keep track of their calories. They joined an exercise program to get more exercise in. They stop watching TV after dinner and they instead go for a walk or they do house projects so they increase their active time of the day. They begin eating a large salad day so they increase nutrient density and they begin taking daily quiet time to write down their thoughts so they begin figuring out where their mind is at and that can be hugely helpful. Now this is can be an overwhelming amount of change. It's too much to handle all at once. You know, so I recommend tackle one at a time. Just get after one of those little changes and focus in on that and do good at that and then try to master the next one. You know, and you know, many people come to us first a lot of times. So they go, I know I gotta get weight to fall off. How do I do that? You know, they come to us because you know we are pretty good at that, and we are experts in that area. And so you know, we're number four, we're increased exercise. So they think to come to us to increase exercise. But while they're here, we help them, we teach them, we help them slowly tackle some of these other changes, these other areas that help them to lose weight one at a time and until finally they've got to that weight that they want to be, they're healthy, they're strong, and they feel great. So hopefully this is helpful. I know it's a little bit long, but I hope you got